We're going to move right into our next keynote. Steve Glenn, the CEO of LivingHomes. Steve Glenn is an entrepreneur committed to positive social change through both for and nonprofit organizations. He is the founder and CEO of LivingHomes, a developer of modern prefabricated homes designed by world-class architects that feature healthy, green materials and energy systems, all at a great price value. And in looking through Steve's information online, it was interesting that Legos actually came into play there. And I think you'll enjoy hearing from him. Steve, it's interesting, in some of his writings, he talks about wedding profit and purpose. And I think that that's an interesting and engaging concept. This idea of developing homes that make great design, functionality, and sustainable design practical and affordable. I'd like to call to the stage Steve Glenn. Would you please join me in welcoming him?
I heard there were going to be a lot of students here, although it seemed like it might be older students, if that's true. So the presentation had that in mind. I'm going to give you probably more background on thinking how I got here than you may care about it. I care to share, but sometimes it's helpful for people that are just thinking about their career. So I'll try to do that quickly. So that's me as a 5-year-old and playing with blocks, and I would make cities, and then Legos, and I would make buildings, and I had books on case study architects, and I wanted to be, frankly, right, I wanted to be an architect. I got to college, and I learned that I had neither the talent nor temperament to be an architect. I also learned that he was actually kind of not a nice guy, so it was like, all right, well, I'm not going to be an architect, but I learned about developers, and one guy in particular, this guy, Jim Rouse, who was actually the first guy to commercialize the mall at Santa Monica Place 1.0. It's actually changed Santa Monica. Frank Gehry was the architect. Frank Gehry worked with Jim Rouse for about 15 years. That's pictures of Faneuil Hall in Boston. So Rouse was the first guy to develop the concept of the festival marketplace. That's Columbia, Maryland, which is in, many consider really the first planned city in the U.S. It was doing new urbanism stuff about a decade before Seaside. In the 80s, he started what is still today the most successful and the largest of the originator of affordable tax credits, the Enterprise Foundation. Now it's just called the Enterprise. So Rouse became very wealthy, very successful doing these things. Oh, by the way, I live in Los Angeles, a little Hollywood moment. His grandson is Ed Norton Jr., who was born in Columbia, Maryland, and he's actually on the board of the Enterprise. So studying Rouse, I got a few things. First of all, he helped turn me on to this concept of companies that successfully went profit and purpose. Now, I was studying Rouse back in college, which for me was the 80s. This is long before social entrepreneurism became popular, and Rouse was practicing in the 50s, 60s, so way before these kinds of concepts were really more widespread. And Rouse, turns out, was a very religious guy, and he felt that it was his God-given responsibility to try to do good work with the work he was doing. Now, to his to investors, he never talked about this, too. Investors, it was all about ROI, and in fact, he did very well with investors. His company, Rouse Company, was public in the 70s, the largest developer of malls. But to employees, he was very clear about how the work that they were doing was really helping to improve communities. And that was, they said, a great, I've spoken to many employees, virtuous research that I've done, a great motivating factor for those of you who are fans of the Good to Great series. The number one biggest correlate, it turns out, between companies that are successful and those who are really successful over the long term are employees' belief in the greater good behind the work they're doing. It turns out that's more of a correlate than a charismatic entrepreneur like Steve Jobs or a very fast-growing industry like high tech. So Rouse was doing that stuff back then. And I, like Rouse, feel an onus to try to add some value through my work. Mine doesn't have a religious background, or although there is a spiritual component to it, so I think. But basically, I have always felt like all of us should take an onus to try to add some value through the work we do. And I realize that teachers and nonprofit workers and people who work in healthcare were doing that every day by virtue of the work they were doing very directly. But I was drawn to commerce, and Ralph showed me that there are businesses where integral in that which makes your company successful, and let's define success in this instance as profitable, because it's hard to maintain a business unless you make profit. Inherent in those things that make your business successful are things that make it purposeful. And when you nail that, and it's hard to create a successful, profitable, growing business, it's not easy to do. But when you do, you can really leverage capitalism, which is an incredibly powerful distribution mechanism. It has absolutely no ethic, but it will help spread your product or service very quickly, very efficiently, if in fact there are buyers and sellers and people like what you're doing. And so I like the idea of creating companies whose products and services are doing some important things, maybe in healthcare, maybe in energy, maybe in the environment, maybe in housing, because then you get to leverage capitalism to spread whatever beneficence you're doing. So Rouse turned me on to that. And by the way, I probably should have mentioned this earlier. You may say, well, how's a mall developer, what does that have to do with socially responsible business? Well, it turns out that when Rouse was working first in developing malls in the 50s, affordable housing was happening in the suburbs, and the suburbs were just homes. And Rouse felt that the suburbs needed some kind of town square. He felt that was really important for the health and vibrancy of any community, and he saw malls as a way to create an all-weather town square. It was kind of a new town square. Of course, by the 70s, you had middle-class folks moving out from town centers, and so he became very concerned, how can I bring people back into city centers? And he came up with the idea of the festival marketplace, first in Boston, then in New York, then in Baltimore, Harbor Place in Baltimore, South Street Seaport in New York, as a way to bring people back into city centers. So that was Rouse's attempt to both create successful projects that also were helping to improve communities. So the second thing Rouse said we appreciate is if you care about the quality of the built environment, developers are much more important than architects because they set the agenda. So they control land, they control budget, so I concluded, well, I should be a developer someday because I have no talent to be a good architect. Developers are more important, and the world could use more responsible developers like Rouse. So I spent a couple decades in tech, mostly in startups, and when I hunkered down to focus on real estate, this is in 2004, 2005, my thesis for a business came very quickly. I concluded that there were a chunk of people who really increasingly value design, right? So these are people using Apple products and buying from IKEA, maybe some pieces from design within reach, and buying Mike Gray's products at Target, and reading Wired and Dwell. These consumers also really value products that are built in a healthy and sustainable way. So we've heard a lot about the Prius drivers and people who shop at Whole Foods or buy organic from Costco, people who wear Patagonia or use organic cotton products. So as I just alluded to, there are lots of companies that target what some people call the cultural creatives. It's a very large and growing group of consumers. The challenge is the production of IGIHOF2015, and ours, Pulte, Centex is the world, don't build for these consumers. So he said, I'm going to start a company that target these guys. And So our formula is just get great world-class architects, try not to screw up the great design work they do, integrate an extremely comprehensive environmental program, and then use prefabrication to make the buildings we do much more efficient. So we started working with Ray Cappy. He's actually planning architecture at Cal State Poly near here, and then he left and started CIARC, Southern California Institute of Architecture. It's one of the top architecture schools in the world. We also worked with Karen Timberlake. They were the AIA firm of the year a few years ago. They're doing the London MC, and they're getting us $1 billion graduate question. And then we also do our own designs. We're using prefabrication because it turns out that if you do this correctly, prefabrication is building off-site, you can much more efficiently build your buildings because several things. One, when you build on site, you have to wait for all the foundation work to be done before you can start working on the vertical and the structure, right? So you've got to put in the foundation and the utilities and all that fun stuff before you can start framing and putting in the plumbing and other trades. Well, with prefabrication, as you're working on the site, you're working on the structure in parallel. So we're able to build in half to a third of the time. Also, you're working in a controlled environment. Now, the factories are not like the factories used to create consumer electronics or cars. There are no robots, there's no CAD-driven equipment that are putting things together. It's the same kind of folks that you would find on the site. However, they're working in a warehouse, so you don't have weather delays. And they tend to be 95 folks instead of subcontractors. Subcontractors have a very famous reputation for not always being reliable and being charitable. When you are dealing with a factory environment, with a production line, things are very predictable, very dependable. So that's why we like building in that kind of environment. And then there's also far less waste. So the average site built home, maybe 30 to 40% of your materials end up in landfill. Indeed, if you talk to the landfill guys, the biggest chunk of materials that they store is actually construction waste. In a factory, prefab, maybe 2 to 10%, 8 to 10% of materials end up as waste because you do shop drawings, so you more carefully map out the materials you need. You order less, and because it's a central facility, you store what you don't use and you reuse it. Whereas the site built guys, it's just not worth it for them to take the materials from one site, store it, take it to another site, so they tend to throw it away. So those are some of the advantages of prefab. So this is showing our homes in various states of undress, and then I'm gonna try to go to the left here if I can. And I'm gonna show you the first home we did was actually my home, and I am actually serious dyslexic, and this is challenging for me. So much so that I'm not going to do it. Well, I assume there's a start button that's not going, but I can't see it there, and I can't see it there. So maybe, try once and then get my slides back on. So would that this were up, what you would see is time lapse of the site and then 11 modules being craned in. So they were put together, well, they were built about 45 minutes from the site in Santa Monica. It took about 3-4 months to build the modules. Now we'll do modules literally in 2 weeks. And then the modules were assembled over an 8.5 hour period. So 11 modules for over 8.5 hours. And so just get the slides up. So you can go to livinghomes.net and So now I'm going to show you that at home. So there are various modules. You can see cranes lifting them, putting them in place. So this is the first home we did, which is my home. And I think one of the two things that are particularly successful about this. One is, if you know Ray Cappy, like it looks like a Ray Cappy home, but it was built, it was assembled in a day. Most Ray Cappy homes take a year or 2 years to put together. Two, this is the first home ever certified LEED Platinum in the history of the program. We've done more platinum-level homes than almost any other design firm in the world, and I'll talk about that later, a little bit better than the previous speaker. But most people don't look at this and go, oh my god, that's such a green home. And that was an important insight we had when we were starting the company, which is there was an energy crisis in the 70s, and there were many green homes that were developed in reaction, as next time we did, also by Ray Cappy. But the homes that were done, straw bale, underground, were oftentimes designs that weren't practical, that weren't desirable by many people. And so our first insight was, let's make homes people actually want to live in. They've got to meet certain functionality requirements, certain aesthetic requirements. Oh, by the way, let's build them in a responsible way. We lead with design. We don't lead with the environmental program. This is the first LEED Platinum multifamily in San Francisco. This is a project we did, our first multifamily in Presidio, designed by Karen Timberlake. This is the first LEED Platinum in Newport Beach, home we did with Karen Timberlake. This is the first LEED Platinum multifamily in Silicon Valley, Ray Cappy. Also, our first affordable units are in there. This is the first LEED Gold in Toronto, Ray Cappy. This is a big project we did in Los Angeles that sold for a lot of money. During the downturn, we took whatever. This is our first low cost home. This is the first LEED Platinum production home that's available on the market. This actually was just certified platinum. So it's a one-story home, 1,300 square feet. It's $139 a square foot, which is for a place like Santa Barbara, definitely for LA, that's actually quite affordable. Some of the other homes I showed were much higher end. So we're now doing affordable housing. This is the first project we did for Make It Right, a nonprofit founded by Brad Pitt to redevelop the area, an area in the lower Ninth Ward that was really devastated after Katrina. So this home is now, in fact, I just heard today, it's got its CEO and a sales pending. So that's when it was installed at the site at Make It Right. We're now doing five homes with Make It Right at the Fort Peck Indian Reservation in Montana. Fort Peck Indian Reservation is the second poorest Indian reservation in the country. Make It Right is doing 20 homes. We're doing 10 of them, and these are will be in production soon. And this is our first development project, which is a six-home single-family in Los Angeles and commercial space of a mixed-use project. So our focus now is much more affordable housing. So you heard about the LEED program, which stands for Leadership in Environmental and Energy Design. And what's nice about LEED is that it gives an objective third-party qualification, certification for buildings. It's time and time again, consumers have shown that in order for a market to really take off, you need an objective third party to verify claims people are making. That's what happened in the organic food industry. It happened on a smaller scale in the wood industry with a group that came together to certify wood, ensuring that it's grown and harvested in a sustainable way. The Forest Stewardship Council, FSC. USGBC has provided that with LEED. The problem with LEED is it's a point-based program. There are many areas that, therefore, you don't necessarily have to do. So, for example, you can, in certain instances, getting a LEED platinum certified home with no photovoltaics, no solar power. And we don't think that's quite right. I mean, we understand the compromises the program needs to make, but we believe that our consumers really care about trying to create homes that reduce their ecological footprint as much as possible. So we developed internally a program we call C6, because for us it really directly identifies and then measures the key metrics we want to change. So we want to make our homes as much as possible zero energy. So most of the homes we've done have been designed to be zero energy, meaning we produce what we need or even more. Zero water. Every home we've ever built is gray water ready. Sadly, not every place that our homes are located allows for gray water, but they're all gray water ready. We think that's just a matter of time, particularly in California. Every place will allow gray water, so they'll be ready to reclaim water for irrigation. Zero emissions, so we care a lot about indoor air quality. We take a lot of time to source materials that don't off-gas harmful chemicals. Zero carbon, zero waste. We care a lot about where materials come from, how they can be recycled. And then zero ignorance. It turns out you can do lots of things to reduce the ecological footprint of your buildings, but frankly, the people who live or work or play in those buildings don't make responsible choices. You're going to have a big ecological footprint regardless of what you've done. So we've got things that give people feedback. So I'm going to very briefly take you through on some of the things we do to reduce impact. These are all things that can be done in any building, whether it's a home or an office, but these are some of the things we do. First of all, for energy, and I should mention, energy is the most important metric to move, because a building will use far more energy over its useful life than is embodied in materials. So it's important to source responsible materials, but it's much more important, in our opinion, to be responsible about how you insulate a building and how you create power for it. And as I just indicated, there's a demand problem. You want to reduce that as much as possible. And then there's a supply problem. So on the demand side, we heavily insulate our buildings. We like to use a blown-in cellulosic or corn-based insulation. It's much more effective than that because it fills all the nooks and crannies. All of our downlights are LEDs, light emitting diodes. They use about a tenth of the power of incandescent, and there's no mercury. We like radiant heating where we can. It's a much more efficient way to heat. We'll preheat with solar energy. All energy star appliances. We put solar panels or photovoltaics on every home we do, and as I said, the majority are designed to be zero electricity. And I've said energy, but I should be more careful. Zero electricity, because we do use gas. So sometimes when you're zero energy, that's really a misnomer, because if they use gas, it's probably not zero energy. Gas is a backup for water heating. For water, all low flow water fixtures, as I mentioned, we all homes are gray water ready, and we encourage our clients to use a drought tolerant native landscape and put in cisterns to reclaim water and use that for irrigation. There is more and more research that is finding that things like formaldehyde urea, which you find in the adhesives in millwork or in carpets, volatile organic compounds that you find in paints and stains, mold, less of an issue here, big issue in the Northwest and the Southeast, can cause skin, head, eye irritation, even some cancers in extreme forms. So we do a lot to minimize off-gassing. So all of our millwork is formaldehyde-free. Where we build our garages, we put in a fan that takes out carbon monoxide that can seep up into the home. We have fans in our motion control in the bathrooms that take out moisture before that moisture can get into the wood and cause mold. We don't use traditional fireplaces. We use fireplaces that burn denatured alcohol, basically ethanol, so there's zero smoke and almost no carbon. We like to integrate gardens into most of our homes. First of all, it's cool. We like indoor gardens, but also we source plants like the spider fern that contribute, that produce a lot of oxygen more than a normal plant, and that filter contaminants from the air. So that's part of our indoor air quality system. In terms of carbon and waste, we do a lot to source responsibly. We use steel a lot. Steel is the most recycled building material there is, basically old cars. Where we use wood, tends to be Forest Stewardship Council certified wood, so that's a nonprofit I mentioned earlier that certifies that wood is grown and harvested in a sustainable way. Cut tile from recycled glass or mirrors. Countertops from cellulose, basically newsprint. I mentioned about our insulation. We work with the reuse people when we are dealing with existing properties. We won't demo those properties, we'll deconstruct them and reuse the materials where we can. One thing we also offer kind of cuts across a bunch of areas, but homes generally are designed to be reconfigured to kind of grow as you grow, right? So you're single, you get married, you have a kid, you have more kids, maybe the in-laws move in, and everybody moves out. Renovation is expensive, it's time-consuming, it's extremely wasteful, so we have features that not everybody takes, like movable walls and millwork that can change. And internal and external space you can add to homes to make the renovation process more waste-efficient, more time-efficient. Last thing I'll mention on the C6 is ignorance, right? So Prius has been mentioned a number of times. I too used to drive a Prius. I have a Volt, and I was very excited to find a charger. Thank you, UCSB, on campus. So my car is being charged right now. So turns out, for those of you who drive Priuses, you know about that system that we obsess over that tells us in real time what our mileage is, and also in increments. It becomes like a video game. You want that mileage to be as high as possible. Well, any system with feedback tends to improve. So we worked with this company, Lucid Design Group, to create a system that gives you real-time energy feedback on your home. And it actually has the capability for water and gas too, although that's more expensive. But it shows you in increments, how you're doing relative to your friends who have these systems. And there's great research that's found that if you just give people feedback on their energy use, it tends to be reduced, that they'll actually reduce their energy use by 15 to 20%. So it's just showing different ways how that system works. Online, just for fun, you can go to livinghomes.in. You can configure your homes like a car. You can add different features to it. You can go inside and pick finishes, and you get to see your lead points that we think are associated with those finishes and fixtures. You can share your virtual living homes with others. So I think I will end there. Do I have time for
questions? Have everybody, if you want us, we're going to take a break right now.
Okay.
If you want to talk to Steve, see him at the break.
Okay.
5 minutes, come on back, we're going to start the ceremony.
I have one really quick question.